A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away. The Phantom Menace. How is it going to all of my fellow apprentices and Jedi Masters? Welcome to the beginning of the Star Wars Watch series on Way Back Wednesday. I'm Sterling Steele. Welcome to Sterling on Cinemas. That's Cinemas with an S. And today, I'll be giving you my review on The Phantom Menace. You can get a sense of how I'm doing this. I'm doing this in chronological order, just like how I reviewed the entire MCU in chronological order. This Star Wars franchise will be reviewed in chronological order with the anthology stories thrown in between. So you will see Solo and Rogue One be reviewed before 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8, and 9. But before I begin, if you're new to this channel, don't forget to like, share, subscribe, leave a comment on the section below, and most importantly, watch. And if you don't, may the Force be with you. And if you're watching this on Instagram, don't forget to follow me if you happen to stumble upon this page. Like if you like it, whether you like it or not, you know. And then comment if you have anything good to say about The Phantom Menace in particular. And yeah, let's get to it. Star Wars Episode 1, The Phantom Menace, sees Obi-Wan Kenobi, who was a young apprentice Jedi Knight under the tutelage of Qui-Gon Jinn, played by Liam Neeson, Jedi Master Qui-Gon Jinn. Anakin Skywalker, who will later father Luke Skywalker and become known as Darth Vader, is just a 9-year-old kid here. When the Trade Federation cuts off all the routes to the planet Naboo, Qui-Gon and Obi-Wan are assigned to settle the matter forever. Now, I will start off by saying this, that even though the Star Wars franchise is an overly complex piece of sci-fi cinema with the different species, the premise of intergalactic battles, the storytelling, the planets, the fate of these characters, and the roles that they play, and most importantly, the Force. There is no denying just how immensely popular these things are and how much impact it has had on pop culture as a whole. When I look at this franchise in its entirety, it makes itself look like it is more popular than the Marvel Universe. I hate to break it to you, but that is false. No need to, I'm not trying to compare, but I'm just saying Star Wars success isn't really like Marvel Universe's. But when it comes to the success of Star Wars, it is probably only 2/3 of that of Marvel. But you know, as far as the first entry in the prequel trilogy, which is not a lot of favorites, I can understand why, but it is really easy to landslide with this one. Because it was stating one thing and telling another. During the iconic opening crawl text sequence that states that there are trading routes going towards different planets, but the trades were stopped at Naboo. That was the opening lines for Phantom Menace. However, I feel like whatever the subtitle of the prequel entries imply, that it will only be a side mission. Or I guess it may not even apply to just the prequel trilogy, but probably every single episode in the series. For example, the subtitle, The Phantom Menace, which is obviously referring to Darth Maul, does not mean that the whole movie is all about Darth Maul, but it leads up to that duel with the apprentice who has a dual lightsaber. Although he is a physical antagonist, the real conflict here is the mystery that lies within Anakin that is only waiting to manifest itself. You know what I'm talking about. We're gonna get there. The main goal of this prequel trilogy is to discover the road to where Anakin Skywalker came from and how exactly he becomes the most powerful Jedi in the entire galaxy. We get a lot of subtle references and foreshadowing about Anakin's fate from other Jedi masters like Yoda and how tight he is with the Force. Like, even tighter than that of Yoda or any other Jedi master, saying that his potential was greater than the current Jedi's now. For this entire series on Star Wars on Wayback Wednesday, which I'm definitely gonna have fun with, this is gonna be a challenge. Like, before I go forward, I will say that I know reviewing this Star Wars series is gonna be a big challenge for me. Like, I'm challenging myself. I'm doing things. I am binge watching films that I wouldn't normally watch as much as the ones that I do like. Does that make sense? Like, I love the Marvel movies. I watch that more than any other film franchise ever, but I've seen the prequel trilogy like a few times. I haven't seen it enough or like invested in it enough to become familiar with all the different characters and the different power rankings and the different governments and all the planets and such. But, So, like I said, for the entire series, I will be mostly focusing on the leading faces and how significant their role is in their respective series, their respective trilogy, and if so, the overall Skywalker saga. Liam Neeson's Qui-Gon Jinn is the first Jedi Master we see chronologically, and we know that he was the first original protege to Jedi Knight Obi-Wan Kenobi, who would eventually go on to be the protege of Anakin Skywalker and the next, his son Luke. This is a tradition that occurs in all three trilogies in order to exemplify how every generation has a chosen one in a million Jedi Knight. Natalie Portman's dual performance as the Queen and Padme was expertly deceptive, not because they were both Natalie Portman, I knew that all along, but because of how it was a plot point for the Queen to be a decoy for the real Padme and vice versa. And also, I want to add on, that's one of the best things about Star Wars. Like, this is one of those franchises that stretches across generations. Like, it brings together generations from old to young to experience these amazing adventures, these out of these world stories. Just like this isn't like how you make a franchise from back in the day, then you reboot it in the modern times, or you make some type of spin-off. No, this is an ongoing. This is a one-way narrative. That's all it is. Like, this is, I would say that Star Wars is one of the few franchises that always plan to be episodic. Because, like, every film franchise never really intends to have a next part unless the people really want it or unless they feel that the story can really go somewhere beyond what was last seen. But Star Wars consciously and willingly goes the next step into telling the story in the Skywalker name. But the role for all of the other characters, like the Galactic Empire and the Imperial Rebels, will remain the same and will eventually get overthrown and replaced later on in the series. Jar Jar Binks is one of the first funny supporting characters in the Star Wars series, with his unorthodox appearance and cringeworthy mannerisms and speech. Like, I can't even understand what this man is saying most of the time. Like, I was guessing that it was a black man. It was a black man because it sounds like a black guy's voice. But anyway, Darth Maul did not receive much screen time despite the title supposedly implying that was the case. His character design is just as devilish and just as grotesque as anything you would ever see. This design was actually inspired by a nightmarish figure seen by the concept artist of a few of the Star Wars films, including The Phantom Menace, making it the best depiction of pure evil because it evokes Satan, it evokes the devil. Now, Anakin Skywalker might just be a kid now, but his fate has been foreseen by a few Jedi Masters, including Yoda, stating that he is the only person who can bring literal balance to the Force. And because of this, it could be for the better or for the worse.
If he is really destined to become more powerful than any Jedi before him, then his high potential level will become a great value to both the light side and the dark side, and we see this get implemented, and it becomes detrimental to Anakin's will, Anakin's own will, as well as his worth to his closest allies. Rotten Tomatoes gives it a rotten 52% score. Like I said, not a lot of people or critics love the prequel trilogy, at least now, in this entry. The origin episode in Star Wars' Skywalker saga might not be an engaging Star Wars film overall, but it tells already familiar fans what they needed to know about how the most powerful Jedi who ever lived came to be. So I'll give it 7.5 SOs out of 10. So that is my review on The Phantom Menace. How excited are you guys to see me cover the Star Wars franchise? Like, I'm pretty sure y'all must have saw it coming, because how can I talk about Marvel? How can I talk about Pixar? How can I talk about two Disney branches without covering this branch? Y'all know me. Y'all know I'm going to cover this. But if y'all have any suggestions on how, like, what type of information I can cover in these reviews about Star Wars, or if I need to know any names of some of these governments and some of these superiorities in the franchise, please let me know. Because like I said, it's a lot of names, it's a lot of titles in this franchise. I don't know everything. Like, I like Star Wars, but I'm not a big fan, you know what I'm saying? Like, I don't like this like how I like Marvel, you know what I'm saying? Like, if you ask me any question about Marvel, I can get that. Like, I'll hit you, but if you ask me any random question about Star Wars, I pretty much know the major characters and a few of the planets, but that's pretty much it. But other than that, I hope y'all enjoyed the review. I'll see you guys later next week, and may the Force be with you.